that the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my hurt. Who am I that the bright and morning star would choose to light the way for my ever wandering heart? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow, a wave tossed in the ocean.
Music set here. The third song we're doing is new to us here at church. It's by Hillsong. It's called The Stand. Talks about God standing before us at creation, and that also kind of challenges us on how we are to stand for Christ and stand before Christ. I know singing is not everybody's favorite form of worship. I know I'm too loud. But we all have different ways that we can be standing before God and worshiping Him. But we're going to ask you guys here in a few minutes to stand and join us singing and worshiping Him. With that, we tied in some verses to try to go along with the songs to help us remember why we come to church and why we worship Christ in song and in offering and different things to try to get you guys out of your comfort zone and me as well every Sunday. Okay. All the nations you have made will come and worship before you, Lord. They will bring glory to your name, for you are great and do marvelous deeds. You alone are God.
But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of Him who called you out of the darkness into His wonderful light.
So then, brothers and sisters, stand firm and hold fast to the teachings we passed on to you, whether by word of mouth or by letter.
May my prayer be set before you like incense. May the lifting up of my hands be like the evening sacrifice.
I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I will remove from your heart a stone and give you a heart of flesh. Please stand and join us in singing.
The mystery he lavishes. Give them one. Take that card that you're getting. Don't look at it. Just put it in the Bible somewhere. We're going to come back to that at the end, all right? So as they're passing those out, let's review where we are at in our series on signs of a healthy church. The first week that we talked about this series, which was 5 weeks ago, we talked about a healthy church being what? Maybe I didn't phrase that question right. Week one of our series, Signs of a Healthy Church, what did we say a healthy church is?
Praying church.
A what?
Praying church.
Praying. You know what? I love the gusto with which you shouted out the arguments. Amen. Hold on to that, Beth. I'm going to come back to you because that was good. We committed.
An abiding church.
Let me just help. Let me help. A fruitful church.
Fruitful. Fruitful.
Excellent job, Brad. I think we're going to go back to that week now. So we talked about being a fruitful church. We are a fruitful church when we are connected to God, right? Remember the vine and the fruit and the root? And we have to be connected to Christ in order to grow, in order to be a fruitful church. Now, the next 2 weeks we talked about, somebody said this one already. I don't know, maybe it was Gail.
Committed.
Committed church. Second sign of a healthy church is a committed church. And remember, a committed church is all about you, right?
Yes.
I like that. How much do I owe him? A committed church is a church that is focused on carrying out the call that God has given them. Committed church isn't about us. It's not about what we get out of church. We don't come here on Sunday mornings to be blessed. Instead, we come here to bless others. We come here to be a part of a growing, active church. Now, let's be honest. One of the nice perks, if you will, about being in a good church is that you walk away often feeling blessed and lifted up. And that's great. But it cannot be about us. It has to be about Christ. It has to be about the church. So we're a fruitful church, we're a committed church, and then, Beth, what was our next one? No, no power. Praying church, yes! Well, you were much more timid that time.
Praying church.
There you go. A praying church. And remember what prayer is, right? It's the heart of man in communion with the heart of God. Prayer is not about us going to God saying, this is what you need to do in order to make me happy. Prayer is not trying to get God in alignment with our desires. It's about us positioning ourselves in alignment with Him. That is what a praying church should be doing. We are desperate. We are urgent to be in communion with God every day of our life. All right. Now, for those of you who felt, you know, I didn't really get a good answer to any of that, I have failed this review, I'm going to give you a bonus question, all right? This should be very easy for all of us to understand what it is. The next question is, what is today's sign of a healthy church? Wow. This is how high school teachers feel this time of year. Alright, today we're going to look at a healthy church. And the sign here is, in fact, evangelism. Evangelism, it's one of those things that we all talk about. We all know how important it is. It's so crucial. But we really struggle to do it. Today I'm going to try to be extremely practical for you. I like to be practical every week, but we're going to really get into some of the nuts and bolts today. So it may feel a little different. I hope it doesn't. I hope you'll stay awake. It's kind of warm in here, I think. Anybody else feel it's a little warm in here? Everybody's comfortable with the couple of you are okay. Well, you come up here with some fans for me. Love it. When you hear the word evangelism or witnessing, do you start to just quiver a little bit in the knees? Do you start to sweat just a little bit because that's such a difficult thing to do? Many people do. They struggle with evangelism. Now, we talk about this idea of evangelism. Evangelism is simply the act of sharing the good news of salvation through Jesus Christ with others around us. And I want you to understand that a healthy church is going to understand evangelism, our calling to go out and to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with those around us. And they're going to want to do it. There's got to be an understanding and an action to it. There's got to be a desire, and then we've got to obey. So this morning, we're going to look at kind of the same format we've been going through the last week. We're going to look at the call. We're going to look at some examples. But we're going to spend the bulk of our time being very practical and looking at the application side of evangelism for us. How do we share the good news of salvation through Jesus Christ with others? Let's look first at our calling. We could go to a whole bunch of different passages in the scriptures to see this call to witness. If you've got your YouVersion Bible up, you can find all these notes in the events tab. You've got notes on the back of your bulletin. Today is a day, I encourage you, not just for Camp Points kids. Today is one of those days I want you to take good notes, because this is something you need to keep and to hold on to. Alright? We can look at passages like Isaiah 52:7. It says, how beautiful on the mountains are the feet of him who brings good news, who publishes peace, who brings good news of happiness, who publishes salvation, who says to Zion, your God reigns. We could look at Christ's own words in Matthew chapter 5, verse 16. It says, in the same way, let your light shine before others, so they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. We could look at Romans 10:14. How are they to hear without someone preaching? Or we could look at 1 Peter 3:15. Always be prepared to give an answer for the hope that you have. Here's just four verses that I think lay out very clearly that we need not only to have a knowledge of salvation and how it works, but to be able and quick to share that with other people. The reality is, we have the good news. Let me rephrase that. We have the goodest news. Yeah, I know, bad grammar. We have the best news that's available, right? You can have a personal, life-changing relationship with Jesus Christ. And yet, so many times we hold on to that as if it's something that, you know, is so precious we can't let it slip out of our grasp. It's more precious as it gets distributed. We have a clear call to witness. Take your Bibles, go to Matthew chapter 28, verses 16 through 20. This is a passage that we often call the Great Commission. If you're using the Pew Bibles on page 527, in Matthew 28, let me give a little bit of context leading up to this passage. In Matthew, we have an account of the life of Christ. And at this point in time, Christ has already died on the cross. He's been resurrected from the grave. He's appeared to his disciples, and he's spending time now before he ascends back into heaven. And he's just really teaching and training his disciples. And in the passage we're going to look at, he calls the 11 to a specific place, and he lays out for them what I really think is the mission or the purpose of today's church. Remember, these 11 disciples that he's speaking to, they're the apostles. They are the ones who become the church. And then they spread that news of the gospel of Christ. So this is Christ speaking to the church, which means we are involved. Matthew chapter 28, let's read verses 16 through 20. It says, now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Verse 19, go therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Now there's two critical verb phrases that will help us understand exactly what Christ is calling us to. This is a passage we usually see kind of connected with missionaries, isn't it? Because they got that whole idea of, I'm going to go out into the world and I'm going to share the gospel. And this is a great passage. And many missionaries use this as kind of their life verse. This is what God has called me to do. And many times, those of us who aren't called as missionaries, we have a tendency to sit back in our pews and go, oh, yeah, the missionary verses. That's great that God calls some to missionary. I'm not called to be a missionary. Well, guess what? I've got a surprise for you today. Because you are called to be a missionary. Not necessarily the same form as the Vanderdeckers who are down in Papua New Guinea, which, by the way, we've got a new card from them. It's on the bulletin board in the back. Take a look at it. We're not called to Brazil, necessarily, or to South Africa. We're not even called down to Texas, perhaps. But we are all, each and every one of us, if you are a follower of Christ, a disciple of Christ, you are called. And the verbs that we're going to look at in this verse quickly, they'll explain it all to us. Now, remember, I struggled in English class. That's why I say things like goodest. I'll give you some Greek today, just to prove that I don't really know Greek that well. The first verb that I want you to see is in verse 19, where it says, go therefore. This is a word that means to go on one's way or to journey. You see the Greek word up there. I practiced it and practiced and practiced it. I'm not even going to try it this morning because my mouth is so dry like that. Koryuoma. How was that, David?
Not bad.
Not bad, he says. I got a C+.
Yes.
ACs get degrees. All right. Go. Christ is not saying in this verse that I want you, Dan, to go from here where you're at, your home, your neighborhood, and I want you to go all the way over to another part of the world or the country, and I want you to go and be a missionary there. Right? This isn't a transplant verse. We're not going to pick it up here and put you here, and this is where you are to bloom. This is your garden. You're going to be a missionary here. That's not what this verse is saying. Because we have this concept that the word go means to be on a journey. So what God is saying is, as you're going through your life, as you're going to work, as you're going to the store, as you're going through your neighborhood, as you're going to work, as you're doing the everyday things, you should be going and doing something. Right? So understand go. It's not a transplant. It is an activity wherever you are. Now let's find out what we're supposed to do. Next key phrase is make disciples. Think about disciples. We automatically go to the 12, right? In Christ. And how did Christ make disciples? He kind of enrolled them into school, in a sense, right? He spent three and a half years, 24/7 with these guys, living with them, building into them, teaching them, and sometimes disciplining, correcting, kind of. I think once in a while he did that. He poured his life into them. They didn't go off to some school. They lived their life with Christ. So as we see how these verb phrases work together, I think we get a clear understanding that Christ is saying, listen, guys, gals, because this is all the church, as you go about your day-to-day activities, make disciples. Make followers of Christ. Now think about how we become a follower of Christ. Well, we have to make a choice, right, to follow Christ. We have to make a choice that He's going to be our Lord. See, we need to accept Him. We need to have this whole salvation experience that we're going to talk about. But before that happens, we have to hear the gospel. Let me read Romans. I mentioned just a part of Romans 10:14. Let me read the whole verse. How then will they, that's talking about unbelievers, the world, how will they call on Him, Christ, whom they have not believed? How are they to believe in Him of whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching? Now, I don't like that word preaching, because you know what that points to? This guy. My job is not to reach this world for Christ.
Amen.
Because I stand up here as a pastor. My job is to equip you to go and reach the world for Christ. Now, in the same vein, as I am going about equipping the saints, I should be leading people to Christ, right?
Amen.
It's all of our responsibilities. But how will they hear if someone doesn't witness? The call is clear. People are dying and going to hell all around us. We have been given the opportunity to share the good news with them so that they can have a relationship with Christ. They can have eternity with Him. That is so key. Now think about many of the examples. And we're just going to focus very quickly on the book of Acts. Acts chapter 2 starts out, and you've got all the believers in the upper room. They're waiting on Christ or the Holy Spirit. There's about 120. And all of a sudden, the Holy Spirit comes, and it changes their life dramatically. And they can't contain themselves. They go out. They have to go out, and they have to share the good news of Jesus Christ. Peter gets up in chapter 2, verses 14 through 47, and he gives this sermon. And you know what? It does not line up with any of the things that we're taught about. There's no 3 points, there's no cute little poem or, you know, little thing at the end. There's no great introduction. It seems kind of like my sermons, I guess, a little bit. He just lays out the fact that Christ died, and then he throws in this little cut. By the way, you killed him. But Christ died for you. Thousands come to Christ. It's Peter sharing his testimony. He's sharing the gospel. So we see a lot of people coming to salvation in a very big picture. Go farther. Acts chapter 6 and 7, we have a man named Stephen. Stephen was not one of the apostles. He's not one of the official clergy of the church. He's called as a deacon, but he has the gift of preaching, and boy, does he let them have it. And because of it, he ends up getting executed, stoned to death by his own. And chapter 8 begins. It says, and there arose on that day a great persecution against the church in Jerusalem. And all the saints were scattered except the apostles. So the persecution on these Christians becomes so severe, people have to leave their home. They leave their jobs. There's no telecommuting going on here. They are out of work. They're out of home. They're out of luck. They're on their own. But notice that verse 4 says, those who were scattered went about preaching the word. We have this big corporate sense of witnessing, like preaching, but then we have a lot of examples of individuals. Personal conversations between 1, 2, 3, 4 people where the gospel is clearly taught. We look at the Ethiopian ruler and Philip. We talk about Peter and Cornelius. We talk about Paul and Silas in the Philippian jailer. One of my favorite stories in all the Bible. Remember, that's where they're in stocks. Paul and Silas are locked up. This big earthquake comes because they're just singing. They're praising God, even though they're being basically tortured. The earthquake comes, and the prison's rocked, and the stocks fall off their feet, and they could run if they wanted to. And the Philippian jailer, he realizes his life is on the line, so he takes his sword. He's already like, oh. Paul's like, oh, hold up. It's good, we're all here. And after listening to these two guys sing all night long, the jailer had to know, what in the world is different about you? And so we have two men take time to share the gospel with a family. And that family comes to Christ. So many accounts, just in the book of Acts, where people are willing to share the gospel of Christ and people respond. That is what the early church did. But sadly, that is not what we do. Several weeks ago, we started talking about commitment to the church, and I threw up a bunch of statistics at you. One of the statistics that I threw up there on the screen was that 90% of Christians today say, yes, it is crucial, it is important that we go and share the gospel with other people. And yet we saw it was a very small percentage of people who actually ever did that. I want to ask you to raise your hand if you've ever shared the gospel. I'm not trying to embarrass you, but think about it. When was the last time? It's one of those things that we know the Bible's clear in the call. We know we're supposed to do it, and yet there's this disconnect between what we know and what we do. And so as we get into our application time, yes, application time early, isn't that great? It's a long application, so we're here. Why don't we share our faith? Think about some of the obstacles or some of the reasons, or maybe we should even say excuses that we give for not sharing our faith. I think we can lump them into three categories. We can begin with what we would call a lack of knowledge. Well, Pastor Dan, I know I'm supposed to share the truth, but you know what? I'm really not sure I know what the truth is. It's just kind of difficult for me. It's gray. I don't know how to share it. This is a real problem in our churches today. And I'm going to tell you, I blame in some ways the church. Because I don't think the church has done a good job, a consistent job, explaining the gospel in an understandable way so that you can then go out and share it. We struggle in almost all of our basic Christian living principles with that. And that's why we can really push small groups here, because that gives you time to really study some part of the Bible or some practical principles and ask questions and get that interaction and just really understand it so you can share it. I blame the church, but for the most part, I blame the individual. I am responsible for my spiritual growth. I am responsible to make sure that I'm seeking out wisdom and direction and understanding when it comes to these things, just as you are in your own life. I mean, think about this. Let's put this in terms we Baptists understand. How many of you are going to go home today and have a pretty big meal on Sunday? No? Some of you? Okay, I know it's hot, so maybe not so good. Would you just have like this massive feast on Sunday and then not eat the rest of the week?
Yes.
Yeah, but you're a vegetarian. You don't count. Sorry to all you vegetarians. That's a thing. We wouldn't do that and expect that we would grow strong and healthy. Because the body is not designed to feast on 1 hour out of the week and then to starve the rest. And yet spiritually, how many of us do that exact same thing? How many of us come here and we get our booster shot of the Bible? And if Pastor Dan's on, it's great. If not, well, you know, it's Slim Pickens. But we go home from here, and we don't touch the Bible, we don't read the Bible, we don't think about the Bible for the rest of the week until it comes to Sunday morning when we're trying to find our Bible so that we have it. Too often, we are to blame for our own lack of knowledge. That's one of the obstacles we face. Another one we face may be a lack of confidence. I've had someone say this to me, Pastor Dan, what if I'm sharing the gospel with somebody and I say it wrong? And that person rejects it, and then they die, and they go to hell because I blew it. That's a tough place to put yourself in. We have this fear of failure. Or what if I shared the gospel with somebody, and you know what? They didn't respond. They just said, oh, okay, thank you, and walked away, and I'm not going to go through that again. I don't want to be a failure, right? We want to be successful. We've got the fear of failure, we've got a fear of rejection. I don't know if you've ever had this. You go to share the gospel with someone, they get belligerent, they get rude, they get downright ornery. Perhaps they shove you away or whatever. Nobody wants to be treated like that. So we have this lack of confidence that oftentimes prevents us from sharing the gospel. Another area we have is a lack of concern. Now understand, I'm not saying that there's anyone in this room who wants someone to die. I don't think you guys are that cold-hearted that you would actually want someone to be separated from God for eternity. But if you think about concern, it's not that we're not concerned about other people and their salvation. Too many times we're more concerned about other things. We might have a wrong understanding of the Bible. Well, you know, I read the Bible that God calls certain people to be saved, and they're predestined, chosen, and elect, and so God's going to save them. I don't have to be involved. I'm sorry. You're right. You don't have to be involved. God doesn't need you to save that person, but He's called you to share the gospel with them. You have a role to play. We may not have a sense of urgency. How many of you woke up this morning and going, this is going to be my last day on this earth? No. Nobody here. Even people I know who have been given a pretty grim prognosis from the doctors, still wakes up anticipating that there will be one more day after this. And yet, we're not guaranteed today. We're not guaranteed tomorrow. Our unsafe friends and family are not guaranteed tomorrow. And we have no sense of urgency when it comes to sharing the gospel. Maybe we struggle with the burden for the lost. We really don't want to consider the impact of dying without Christ. The eternality of that decision. Maybe we fail to see people as God sees them. Yes, I know I've got to love everybody, but the Bible says it doesn't say I have to like them. We sometimes get so focused on people's faults and their sins and their quirks that we forget that they are just like us and that we are all sinners. Amen. We need to be saved by grace. Amen. More often than not, I think it's because we're focused on ourselves more than anyone else. Our own plan, our own agenda, this is my schedule. I could give you probably several examples from my own life where I've had a plan and I've had an agenda and someone has come and talked to me and I kind of brush them off. And later I'm sitting back going, what are you doing? There's an opportunity to build into somebody's life, to share the gospel. And you're just so focused in on yourself, you missed that opportunity. Last spring, about this time of the year, I had 5 different people in this church come to me and say, Pastor Dan, I want to be able to confidently share my faith. They had specific people they were targeting. They said, I want to be able to witness to them, to share the gospel. And I said, you know, it's like a group of you that are seeing this. I think we ought to do a workshop where we get a lot of people together and they can learn how to do it. And this is great. And so we promoted it, we planned it. We're going to do 3 weeks on Wednesday nights. 3 people showed up. Kelly and I were 2. We know that we're supposed to do these things. And I don't say that to embarrass anyone. This is just a glimpse at where we all are, I think. We know we're supposed to do things like this and share the gospel. But when it comes down to actually doing it, we struggle. For whatever reason, could be lack of knowledge, lack of confidence, whatever it is. We've got to overcome these obstacles. When it comes to overcoming this obstacle of a lack of knowledge, we need to be able to clearly communicate the basic gospel. We need to be able to quickly and concisely lay out for someone what it means to be a Christian. And because this is the application portion, because this is so important in our life, we're going to spend a little bit of time this morning walking through what the gospel really is. I'm going to try to just get it down to the bare essentials. And here's what's going to happen, right? I'm just going to put on my prophet hat. There's going to be some people who say, but you forgot about this verse, or you left this out. We're going to try to just streamline this. I'm going to try to make this simple. Because if I start throwing you 47 points and you know a whole bunch of $4,000 words from seminary, you're all going to sit there and go, I don't know. I want you to be able to take that bulletin insert and just walk up to someone and say, no, this is what the gospel is in its simplest form. And get that opportunity to share the gospel. So let's talk about 5 key things about salvation. Number one, every person is a sinner. We don't have to spend much time on this because, you know, look around you. We are all sinners. Amen. And if you don't believe that, look at me. Because I'll say what Paul said, I'm the chief here. I've done it all wrong. I've been selfish, whatever you name it. Romans 3:10, as it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. Romans 3:23, all have sinned. We all fall short of God's glory, that standard of holiness that we need to have a relationship with Him. Every person is a sinner. Point number 2, sin has a penalty. The penalty is the death penalty. And that is a penalty that must be paid. Romans 5:12 says, therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, So death spread to all men. That one man that they're referring to in that verse is Adam. Go back to Genesis chapter 3 in your mind. You know what happened, right? Adam and Eve in paradise. One rule. All you had to do was one thing. And they disobeyed God. And with that came death. Physical death in the sense that the body now would die. It would fall apart. It would feel much like mine today. And eventually the heart would stop working, the brain would stop functioning, and this body would cease. But it's also talking about eternal death, that permanent separation from God. We are all sinners, first of all, because of Adam. Adam's sin, his consequences come down on us all. But let's not feel too high and mighty, because here's the reality. We all have sinned as well. Romans 6:23 says, the wages of sin is death. Remember what the word wages means. We most often put it in the picture of work, right? I work X number of hours, you pay me X dollars per hour, therefore my wages are hours times pay. I earned that. I deserve that pay. Well, friends, guess what? Because of our sin, we deserve the penalty for sin, which is death, separation from God. Sin has a penalty. Has to be paid. Hebrews 9:22. Under the law, almost everything is purified with blood. Without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sin. Think back through the Old Testament, even into the Gospels. This system of sacrifices that was in place in Israel was all to point to Christ. They offered these animals, they shed blood in order to provide a temporary covering for their sin. Because they could not pay for their own sins. So someone else had to do it. Next point in salvation, we see that Christ paid for these sins. That's the good news. Christ came in our stead, and he paid for our sins. See, our sins can't be forgotten. They can't be ignored. God can't just say, well, Dan, you know what? I really like you, and I'm a big Hawkeye fan, so because of that, I'm going to let you slip on these. No. That would not be a holy and righteous God. There is a penalty for sin that must be paid. But God looked at us and said, you can't do it. And because you can't do it, I'm going to send Jesus Christ. From Spider-Man, God shows his love in this simple fact that even while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. I love how 1 Peter 3:18 says it. Christ suffered once for sins, the righteous, meaning Christ, the perfect one, the sinless one, the holy, the pure, the one who didn't deserve to die, stepped in our place, the unrighteous, the sinners, the unholy, the impure. Christ, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God and put to death in the flesh. Christ did all of this so that we could have a relationship with our Creator God. This might be the most difficult point for people to get today, that salvation is a free gift. All the time we hear, well, you get what you pay for. Nothing good comes free. Nothing good comes easy, right? We probably have told our children that, parents. And please do not think that salvation is free in the sense that nobody paid anything for it. It is not cheap. The price that was paid for your salvation, for my salvation, was the greatest price that was ever paid. It was the very life of God through Jesus Christ himself. But he paid it because I can't. He paid it so I don't have to. He paid it so that I could have a relationship with God. Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death. We deserve death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. Ephesians 2:8-9, for by grace you've been saved through faith. It's not your own doing, it is the gift of God. Not a result of our works, of one who boasts. Titus 3:5, he saved us. Not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to his own mercy, by the washing, regeneration, and renewal of the Holy Spirit. Listen, friends, there is no collection of works that you or I can do that makes me worthy It is only through Christ. And now he offers that free gift to us. So this brings us to, I think, the fifth point. Each person must choose to accept that gift. It's not forced on us. It's not thrown in our face. It simply says that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. I'm going to give you the key word when it comes to salvation in my mind, and it's the word believe. John 3:16, God so loved the world that whosoever what?
Believes.
Let's say whoever goes to seminary and learns all the big words and knows the difference between soteriology and this ology, and knows the difference between ransom theory and redemption theory. None of that matters. Whoever believes, what do we believe? Well, we believe that we're sinners, that we can't save ourselves, or that debt needs to be paid. Christ died for our sins so that we wouldn't have to, and now we accept that gift of salvation. And you know me, very simple, right? ABC. Admit that I'm a sinner. Believe Christ died to pay for my sins. Commit my life to Jesus as my Lord. It is really simple to begin a relationship with Christ. Go back to the thief on the cross. Thief on the cross, they're dying. No way. Here's a guy who makes emergency about it, right? I'm dying. I am going to be dead very soon. And I'm looking at this man next to me, who I know did no sin, who I've heard all these things. This must be the Messiah. And he says to himself, when you get into heaven, would you just remember me? He didn't say, would you be in my heart? He didn't say, forgive me of all my sins. He didn't have all the nomenclature words that we like to use. But the attitude, I think, was there. Because Christ's response today will be with me in prayer. Salvation at its simplest thing. Now, is there more to salvation? Oh, yes. Thank God, yes. But you don't have to know these things. Knowledge isn't what saves us. Jesus Christ is what saves us.
Amen.
There's just a little cheat sheet that you now have that you can use. If you want others, I can give you the Romans Road, the four spiritual laws. We're talking about the cross. We can pull out a Rubik's Cube and do a lot of different things. Because you need different ways to reach others. First obstacle to overcome is the lack of knowledge. If we learn how to clearly communicate the basics of the gospel, we can overcome that lack of knowledge. What about this lack of confidence? Well, I think this boils down to really knowing your true role when it comes to sharing the gospel. Too many times we approach people and we think in our minds, what can I say? What can I do? What can I present to persuade this person to accept Jesus Christ as their Savior? You are not a Holy Spirit salesperson. It is not your job to get them into this church or this religion today. Right? You think back to that passage in Matthew. It said, go and make disciples. It didn't say go and convert. Your role is not to save people. Your role is to share the gospel. And if we do that, if we define success in witnessing, not as a conversion, but as a simply sharing the truth, we win every time we share.
Amen.
There's no failure involved. They have to make the decision to accept Christ through the working of the Holy Spirit. That's not our call. We could have the fear of rejection. But what if they say no? Well, let's be honest. They're going to say no, probably. Last statistic I saw, and I'm still not sure how they got this, but a person needs to hear the salvation plan 7.6 times before they're ready to accept it. 7.6. You know what? If you're number one, you may be rejected. But what if you're 7.6? Man, there's no greater joy in this world, and I have seen babies born. There's no greater joy than to see a person born into the kingdom of Christ. And to be there when that happens, or to even be a part of it, oh, it's a great feeling. And I've shared the gospel many times, and I've never once had someone slap me upside the head and beat me for that purpose. It happens other times, not for sharing my faith. The reality is, more often than not, we may get a, well, thank you, I appreciate you having to think about it. We're not going to get persecuted. Most likely, we're not going to be dragged into court, stoned outside the city gates. But even if we are, think about how Christ was rejected for us. It just puts it in a different perspective. Learn your true role in witnessing. Third obstacle is that lack of concern. I think we solve this by having a heart as God does for the people around us. We need to see people as God sees them. You know, I look out and I see you, and I see you guys in so many different ways. I see retired couples. I see people who, for some reason, come up here in the summer to stay. I see men and women who work hard. I see kids who are struggling in school and in relationships. I see families that they're doing the best they can and they're trying to get through it. And I have all of these different ways that I can view you. And you probably got 1,000 for me, depending on how our relationship is. God sees everyone in one of two ways, with or without. And when we start seeing those people who do not have Christ in mind as Christ sees them, as sinners who are going to an eternity separated from God because of their lack of salvation, maybe we will sense our true calling. Maybe we'll be more willing to step out of our little comfort zone, our little bubble as we used to do in youth group, and share the truth with those around us. The more we pray for people, the more we'll see them as Christ sees them. The more we see people as Christ sees them, the more we're going to love them. The more we love them, the more we're going to share the gospel with them. There's going to be a desire for them to be a part of the family of God. So the challenge today is pretty simple, actually. I believe every day God brings people into your life that need Christ. Family, co-workers, could even be that person sitting next to you in the pew. Just because they're here doesn't make them Christian. We need to have the knowledge, the confidence, and the concern to go and share the gospel. Take out that little piece of paper you got at the beginning of the sermon. On that, you're going to see three blank lines. In the statement above, it says, three people in God's help I want to witness to. What I want you to do right now, praise team, you can come on up, get yourself ready. But I want you to take just a moment, and I want you to think through three names. Three people that you know need Christ. I've got my own hit list already. But here's what I want you to do. Write those three names down. Keep it in your Bible. And when you are going through your morning prayers or afternoon prayers, whenever you do that, your personal time with Christ, pull that paper out. And I want you to say, God, help me to see these people as you see them. Help me to have the courage that I need in order to give the gospel to them when I get the opportunity to. Pray that God will give you those opportunities. And then pray that God will help you to see those opportunities. Because as many times I know I'm distracted. And I believe, not by writing the name on paper, it's not like some magic thing, but by keeping them in the forefront of your minds, and praying that God would open your heart and their heart, you are going to have an opportunity to share the gospel with them in the days to come. And I challenge you. You know what? On June 10th, when we do our celebration dinner, I would love it if someone said, oh, by the way, Pastor, we got another one in the kingdom of God. It's not about our lives. It's not about building our kingdom, is it? It's about building the kingdom of Christ. We want to be a healthy church. In order to be a healthy church, we have to see our calling to share the gospel. We have to have the confidence to do it. We need to be obedient to that calling in our life. Would you stand as we have a word of prayer? And then we'll sing one more song. Father God, as we kind of come to a conclusion this morning, I just want to thank you. I want to thank you for giving me up. My Sunday school teacher, when I was a little squirt who shared the gospel with me, and while she didn't lead me to the Lord, my parents did, she planted seeds that made me go home and ask questions. I thank you for each of the individuals that have built into our lives, who have gotten us to this point where we have a relationship with you. And now, Father, I pray that we would have the courage and confidence and the knowledge that we need and the desire to be obedient to your word. To not just